Good morning, and welcome to Shutesbury Community Church. It is the Sunday after Easter, and we are just so glad to be with you this morning. Those of you who are at home and the three of us who are here, and we would like to welcome you into our service as we praise and worship God. And we'll begin with the first song, Blessed Assurance.
So Blessed Assurance is a hymn that is written by two women. Phoebe Knapp was a rather rich lady, and she owned a mansion, and she had a beautiful music room, and one night she asked her guests to go into the music room because she had written a new melody. So she played the melody, and one of the guests that was there was Fanny Crosby, who happened to be blind. And she heard the melody and immediately said, "I know the words for that song, and it sounds just like Blessed Assurance."
That you would open our ears so that we may hear your voice. Open our minds so that we may receive your eternal wisdom. Open our spirits so that we may know your leading and guidance. Open our hearts so that we may receive your love. We ask all this in the glorious name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our second song this morning is Jesus. Jesus.
Hallelujah, if this house is with me, you have broken.
into our prayer time, I'm going to start by reading Psalm 142, which is a maskil of David. Nobody knows exactly what a maskil is. It probably has something to do with music, because David was a poet and songwriter. And he wrote this when he was in the cave, it says in the Bible. There were a couple times that he was hiding out in caves. And I thought it was kind of appropriate for the time that we're living through right now, because we're sort of all living in caves too, and we have a terrible enemy who is outside of our caves, just as David did. So we're gonna read this together this morning. I cry aloud to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. I pour out before him my complaint. Before him I tell my trouble. When my spirit grows faint within me, it is you who watch over my way. In the path where I walk, people have hidden a snare for me. Look and see, there is no one at my right hand. No one is concerned for me. I have no refuge. No one cares for my life. I cry to you, Lord. I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. Listen to my cry, for I am in desperate need. Rescue me from those who pursue me, for they are too strong for me. Set me free from my prison, that I may praise your name. Then the righteous will gather about me because of your goodness to me. So let us pray this morning. Lord, as this COVID-19 continues, and as we are continuing to be in our caves, or so it feels, and the enemy is outside, not people, for many are working on our behalf, and we're very thankful for that, Lord. But this illness, which is at least in Massachusetts, not yet subsiding, we just have to pray, Lord, that you will be there with us, that you will be our guiding light, that you will be our Savior in this time, that you will be our strength, that you will fill us with your love and with joy in our lives right now. Lord, we know that you are the mighty God, and we know that you have all things in control. We know that from bad you make good. We know that ultimately your plan, all of your plans, will happen. And we know that we are in your good graces because we have chosen Jesus Christ as our Savior. And your promises are powerful. Your promises are plentiful. And you tell us again and again through your word how much you love us and what plans you have for us. And that ultimately your plan for us is to spend eternity with you. And we are so glad and so fortunate, so blessed, Lord, that you have chosen us and that we have chosen to be yours. And Lord, we pray in this time that more and more people will turn to you, will open their hearts and their minds and their souls to you, that their spirits will reach out to you, Lord, in this time, that they will come to know the love and the peace and the joy and the grace of Jesus Christ. We pray, O Lord, for our neighbors, for our friends, for our relatives who don't yet know Jesus. We pray for people around the world to turn their eyes and their hearts to you. We pray too, Lord, that this coronavirus goes away quickly, that we can return to normal life, but that we return as different people, that we return more loving and more caring toward one another, that we can more strongly reach out to the world and help you to solve some of the world's problems, Lord. For we are your hands and feet and your voice. And we pray that you will use us mightily as the days go by into the future. Lord, we pray this morning for all who have suffered with this coronavirus. Many have died. Many are ill. And we just pray, we pray for your compassion and your love upon the families of those who have died and those who are greatly ill. And we pray for healing for those who are ill with this disease, Lord. We pray for those who are making mighty efforts to provide help care, provide food through the grocery stores, provide all of the essentials of life that are continuing out there. We pray for their safety. We pray for their help, for their health, and we thank them for their help, Lord. We thank them for their dedication and their devotion. And we pray your grace upon each one of them. Lord, we pray this morning for Gordon, for Kiki, for David, and for Beth, who are all battling cancer. And we pray your love and your peace to them. And we pray your healing hand upon each one of them. We pray for their families who have to stand strong during this time. And we know how hard that is, Lord, to stand strong in such a time as that, especially in such a time as this. And Lord, we thank you that Carly, who we've been praying for 2 years now here in this church, is now in remission. And we are just so pleased and thankful, Lord, that that young woman, still a teenager, is doing so much better. And Lord, we pray for her future. We pray that you will give her grace and give her peace and your love. We pray for elderly and shut-ins. There's been so much tragedy in nursing homes, Lord. And we know that there are people from our congregation who have relatives, mothers, fathers, brothers and sisters who are living in assisted living or in nursing homes. We pray for Chris Footett's mom. We pray for Nancy's mom. And we pray for the rest, Lord, that are in those situations where they're most vulnerable. And we pray that you will grace them with your love and with your healing and with your safety that you alone can give. And Lord, we pray for our community. We pray for everyone here in Shutesbury. It's been a difficult time, especially in isolated towns like this, I think, because you're already isolated by miles between houses, many of them. And then not to be able to go out and spend time with friends. Here in Shutesbury, they've begun howling at 7 o'clock at night, so they at least can hear each other from a distance, howling from their porches. And it seems like a silly thing, Lord, but people are social creatures. We weren't made to be alone. And so we pray for each person here in this community, that you will bless them, that you will place your love upon them, and that you will put your joy in their hearts. We pray that you will draw each one of them to you, so that they will come to know you. And Lord, we pray for our country and the world. We pray for all of the leaders who are making tough decisions right now. We pray that they will stop arguing and bickering and being political and just work together for the betterment of our country and of all the rest of the countries in the world. We just pray, Lord, that they will put their best foot forward, will have a spirit of compromise, will work together, and will make the best of this situation. Lord, we thank you because of Jesus. We thank you because of blessings you give us. We thank you because you are mighty and merciful. And we lift you up. We praise your name. You are our holy God. And we shall yell it from the rooftops. We love our God. We love our Jesus. And we pray all this in his holy name. Amen. We have been receiving offerings through these past couple of weeks on occasion, and so I thank everyone who has sent in their offerings. I thank those who are not part of the church and who are sending in offerings and donations to the church. And again, I would just like to say that we're trying to meet our budget every week, and we're not doing so it would be great if people did send in their offerings or donations. They can be mailed to Shutesbury Community Church, Post Office Box 679, Shutesbury, Mass. 01072. Or you can go to shutesburychurch.org and a menu bar is up in the top right. Click on those and you will get a donation button on the next page. Or you can simply type in to your browser, paypal.me/ShutesburyChurch, and that will take you directly to a donation page. And we do appreciate whatever we get, whatever you can send, even a small amount would be terribly helpful to us. And so let's pray over the offerings that we have received this week. Holy Father, we're just so thankful that you have blessed us in such great and powerful ways. We know that this is a difficult time, that many people have been laid off, and people are kind of scrambling for money. The government is trying to help with that, but a lot of people's checks are not coming through the way they're supposed to or the way it was planned for. So Lord, we know it's a difficult time, but we also know that you have work to do in this world, and part of the work that you do in this world is through this church. And so we're just so thankful, Lord, that you have blessed us in great ways, and we're just so thankful for the donations that have come in, and we pray that they will be used in your will and always to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, Veronica got here a little early today and turned the heat on, so it's warmer than it was last week, and I'm sweating a little bit, so just take a second. I did not say earlier that I am Pastor Mark Ellis here at Shutesbury Community Church. Veronica is our worship leader, and our Christian Ed director, Ann Ellis, is running the camera again today. I'm getting better at it every week. Our sermon this morning is on the ascension. Last week we talked about Jesus' death on the cross and his resurrection from the grave. And then there were 40 days. And we're going to skip over those 40 days and talk about what happened at the end of those 40 days when Jesus ascended up to heaven to the right hand of the Father. In a sermon on Christ's ascension, some years ago, pastor and theologian John MacArthur remarked that it's really inappropriate that we have holidays marking the births of famous people, such as Martin Luther King and George Washington, because at the times of their births, they'd accomplished nothing. And there was no way of knowing if they ever would. Now, sure, their parents had great plans, no doubt, for them, but who knows if those ever would have become completed plans or if they would have gone a totally different way. So MacArthur suggests that instead of celebrating the dates of the birth of people, that we celebrate on the dates of their deaths, because at that point, their work in their life has culminated. They have finished. And we know what they've accomplished in their lives. And we can celebrate those accomplishments as we acknowledge the dates of their deaths. The only person for whom this is not true is Jesus. As MacArthur points out, the only person who ever lived whose accomplishments were written before he was born was Jesus Christ. His accomplishments were known long in advance of his birth through the prophecies of the Old Testament. And that is why, for example, the Magi traveled so long, so much distance and so much time to kneel at his feet and worship him when he was but a young child. They knew from Old Testament writings just what Jesus would accomplish in his lifetime. And so for Jesus, we have the celebration of Christmas, and should have it, the celebration of his birth, and the celebration of Easter, the celebration of his death and resurrection. But what we're talking about today is his ascension. How does that fit into this picture? His ascension seems like it would be a simple response to his birth. He comes down from heaven, and then he goes back to heaven. A very simple matter. And yet, I think there's a lot to celebrate for his ascension. I think it means a great deal, and we're going to talk about what it means. And despite that it means a great deal. Very few Christian denominations today give it much attention. The Ascension also is part of our statement of faith, and we are continuing our statement of faith series. So let's begin this morning by reading the statement of faith together, which will be on the screen. There is one God existing eternally as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the Holy Trinity. The Bible is the inspired word of God, God breathed, written through human agents, carried along by the Holy Spirit. It is the word intended by God and the foundation of our faith and practice. All people have sinned, earning eternal death, separation from God, and only by grace through personal faith in Jesus Christ can we receive forgiveness and eternal life. Jesus Christ, God with us, was born without human father, lived a sinless life, died on the cross to pay the penalty for our sin, rose bodily on the third day, ascended to the Father's right hand, and will return visibly one day to earth. At the end of time, the bodies of the dead will be raised, the redeemed will enter fully into eternal life, the lost into eternal separation from God. As Christ's body, the church, we are accountable to God and one another to live a life separated from sin and filled with the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, and peace, etc. It is both our privilege and our duty to join in the fulfillment of Christ's great commission to make disciples of all nations. So today, we're looking at one short phrase in the statement of faith. Jesus Christ ascended to the Father's right hand. And we're going to consider the significance of that statement. Why is it so important, the ascension, that we include it in our statement of faith? After all, again, as I said before, if Jesus came down from heaven, it's logical that he's going to go back up to heaven. And in fact, he said that himself in John 16, 28. He said, I came from the Father and entered the world. Now I am leaving the world and going back to the Father. But Jesus didn't simply go back to the Father. He didn't simply go back to heaven. It was not a simple matter with simple results. He accomplished a great deal in the single act of going back to heaven. Because things were completely different when he went back to heaven from when he came down from heaven. As we talked about last week, the world had changed in those 30 years that Jesus was on earth. It had changed dramatically. It had changed completely in many ways. And because of his death on the cross and his resurrection, we had all kinds of new things to consider, which we talked about last week. As his ascension also brought change. And it was not a simple, unmeaningful act, but rather like his death on the cross and his resurrection, it changed everything for us. So let's begin by reading the description that Luke wrote of Jesus' ascension to heaven in Acts 1, 1 through 12. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, He was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. Some of the reasons the ascension is so important are in this writing by Luke, at least hinted at. And so we're going to look at those, but we're also going to look at some others, because some of the reasons were expounded by the apostles, and some of the reasons Jesus himself stated during his life on earth. We're not going to make an exhaustive list, because it would be way too long, but we'll consider some of the highlights, and that should give us a strong sense of why the ascension was so important. So the first one we're going to look at is the most obvious one, because it's stated many, many times in the Bible. The ascension enables Jesus to sit at the Father's right hand and rule the world. Several times in the story of Jesus' death and resurrection, as well as numerous times in the letters of the New Testament and the prophecies of the Old Testament, Jesus' ascension to the right hand of the Father is mentioned. In Luke 22:69, Jesus himself states, "From now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the mighty God." But I discovered something really interesting in my research this week. Now, I've read Revelation a few times, but I never noticed this one comment that's very interesting. I've always pictured Jesus rising up to heaven and then sitting at the right hand of the Father in his own throne. Maybe a little bit smaller than the Father's throne. You know, there's Dad and there's Jesus the Son in a little bit smaller throne, like the medieval times with the king and the prince next to each other. But it's interesting. In Revelation 3:21, it says, "To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne." So Jesus isn't sitting in his own throne. He's sitting with the Father on the Father's throne. They're co-rulers of this world, ruling this world together. And look what else it says in there is, "We who are victorious will get to sit on Jesus' throne, which is the Father's throne." How do we become victorious? Well, in the previous sentence in Revelation, Jesus says that he will knock, and whoever opens the door to him will be with him. So to be victorious requires only that when he knocks, we open the door. What a wonderful, wonderful offer that is from our Lord and Savior. The second thing that could not happen if the ascension hadn't happened is Christ preparing a place for us to go after our deaths. Jesus said in John 14:2, "My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you?" Now, we don't really know if Jesus was speaking metaphorically or literally, but in any case, we know that whether there's a room in a mansion for us, which sounds wonderful, of course, we know that Jesus is preparing a place for us to go to. That's why he went back. That's one of the many reasons that he went back to heaven. And going back to heaven enabled him to do. If Jesus had not ascended after his death and resurrection, he could not be there preparing a place for us. The third is also one that Jesus pointed out himself. He could not have sent the Holy Spirit to be with us. In John 16:4-7, which is on the screen, Jesus tells the disciples, "I did not tell you this from the beginning, because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. None of you asks me, 'Where are you going?' Rather, you are filled with grief because I have said these things. But very truly I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you." What would we be today as servants of Jesus Christ without the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit enables us to understand God in a whole new way, to grow in our righteousness, to spread the message of the good news of Jesus Christ, and to do so many other things. And so it's so important that the Holy Spirit came, and that could not have happened if Jesus had not ascended. Fourth, because he ascended, Christ is available to all of us. And he's available to all of us at the same time. When he was on earth, Jesus lived in space and time. And so he could not be accessible to everybody at the same time because he was stuck in one place for that period of time. He could not be preaching in Galilee and at the same time teaching in the temple in Jerusalem and at the same time having a wonderful lunch made by Martha in Bethany. But now, because he has ascended, he can be with us all at the same time. We can each have a personal relationship with him. We each can pray to him, and he is there with us anytime we want him or need him. Fifth, because he ascended, Christ now stands before God as our advocate. His death on the cross and his resurrection from the dead would have been for nothing if he hadn't ascended, if he hadn't returned to heaven as our intercessor. Justin Dillehay, a Tennessee pastor and author, wrote, "We mustn't take 'it is finished' to mean that nothing else needed to happen in order for us to be saved. If Christ hadn't risen, the only thing finished would have been us." The Apostle Paul also commented on this in 1 Corinthians 15:17-18. "If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost." So if he did not rise back to heaven, then all that he went through would be for naught. Sixth, the ascension enables us to receive spiritual gifts. Jesus said in John 14:12, "Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father." Because he went to the Father, he enabled the Holy Spirit to provide gifts to us. And so as a result of that, we can operate as Christ's body, the church, in the present age. Because of his ascension, we have skilled leaders, wise teachers, gifted workers, and loving servants in the church who are Jesus' hands and feet and voice in this world at this time that could not have happened. This is only a small sample of the things that the ascension of Christ accomplished. There are so many more. The ascension enabled the crowning of Jesus as King of kings and Lord of lords. It established him as our high priest. It defeated sin and death. It put the devil on notice. It ensured Christ's final victory. And it enabled his second coming. And aren't we all waiting for his second coming with just a great anticipation? And with his second coming, the arrival of a new heaven and a new earth, a place where there is no pain, where there are no tears, where there is joy and love. The ascension does not minimize or replace what happened on the cross or the resurrection from the tomb. Rather, it completes them. It's the final act, the final necessary act. As the author of Hebrews wrote in Hebrews 7, 24 to 25, because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for him. Because Jesus ascended, he always lives. He is forever. To conclude this morning, I want to read a quote from that John MacArthur sermon that I mentioned earlier. MacArthur is one of my favorite people to read, and he's just powerful in his writing. The story of Jesus began in heaven when he left and came to earth, and it ends when he leaves earth to return to heaven. The story began with condescension, and ends with ascension, began with incarnation, and ends with exaltation, began with expectation, and ends with consummation. It began with the Son of God being born of a virgin, descending to earth, and it ends with the Son of God being born from the dead, ascending to heaven. The story began with hope unrealized, and ends with hope fully realized. It began with a promise and ends with a fulfillment and a new promise. And the story began with praise and worship, and it ends the same way. So today, as we consider the ascension of Jesus, let's do so with praise and worship, because it was through his ascension that he completed the mission, that he fulfilled his earthly purpose, and that he made it possible, finally, for us and for all of humanity to choose him and to live life everlasting in his grace and love. Let us pray. Holy Jesus, we thank you so much for your life on earth, for condescending to come to be among us, to teach us of the kingdom of God and invite us to be part of it. We thank you so much for going up on that cross and taking our sins upon yourself and suffering in our place. We thank you so much that you rose from the grave, that you walked out of the tomb, and that you continued your teachings for 40 days. Ensuring that we too could rise, be resurrected from the dead. And we thank you that you ascended to the Father, that you can be our advocate, our King, our Lord for all eternity, and that you will bring a new heaven and a new earth in our future. We thank you for all of these things, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Our final song this morning is Sing to the King.
So this is one of Shutesbury's favorite praise songs, Sing to the King. I have sadly missed you all here singing with me. And if you were here today, I would be passing out the egg shakers and the tambourines and whatever. So if you have any of those things at home, go grab them. A pot and a spoon would work, but something from the kitchen. But please sing and play along with us.
Sing to the King who is coming.
attached through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all fullness of God.